So this is actually work we have done as a project together, like me and I'm Andreas Kumpft and the others you see here on the slide. And it's a more researchy project we do at TU Berlin. And yeah, it's about efficiently executing R data frames. R is like missing on this slide, sadly, on Apache Flink. And just to give you a motivation, why would we actually want to do such a thing, executing R distributed? So R got huge traction recently. So for instance, on the IEEE language ranking, it's on the 5th place currently, and it rose like quite a lot in the last recent years. It's open source when you compare it to other statistical programming languages. And yeah, it has a really rich support for analytics and statistics. But standalone, actually, R is not really that performant, especially if you execute on large amounts of data. So therefore, there exist multiple extensions to enable executing huge data loads within R. And one of them would be Hadoop and R. One of them would be Spark R, actually. And another, like, not really in this direction is SystemML, which enables you to execute efficient linear algebra in R. And yeah, we want to be in this space as well, so we said, okay, let's integrate Flink with R. And so just to motivate our goals, basically, the first actually goal was to provide an efficient or a natural API for R users, so that you do not have to deal with a data set and you execute a flat map, a map, and an aggregate and such stuff, but more like real R syntax. So in the first line here, you see a select where you specify a select over the data frame df, and then you say, I want to project out of this data frame, which has, let's say, 10 columns. I only want to have the columns distance and flight, and actually, I also want to rename my column flight to f. The second one would be, I have in my data frame a column which has the miles for, I don't know, the distance in flight. And I want to introduce a new column which reflects the miles translated to kilometers. So I execute this user-defined function. Or the last one, basically, I want to do a more an apply function on the data frame. And I say, I want to aggregate by the ID in my data frame. And then I execute an user-defined aggregate function. And so while we have this, basically, this API, the second goal is we want to achieve comparable performance to native executing on the Dataflow engine, in our case, Flink. And to go with the general approach, so how would we do that? So basically, when you think about we treat an R data frame, we can represent it in Flink as a data set of tuple n when we have a data frame with n columns. So we treat a data frame as a data set of tuple n with n tuples, elements. Sorry. Then we would create from this R program we specified before, we create an execution plan, like we would also do lazily in the Flink API. And then there are actually two steps you want to do while you create this execution plan. The first one is, in order to achieve performance, you want to map data frame functions that you can map to the native API whenever possible. What does that mean? Like in the examples I showed you before, the select statement is nothing else than a project statement in Flink. So I don't have to execute any user-defined code of R. I just can execute the native project call in Flink API, which then gives me native performance. The second thing is, like I showed you when we translated the miles to the kilometers, this is an actual user-defined function. So we have no other option than to execute this R user-defined function. And to achieve really good performance, we have to focus on this point. So we have to be careful about how we execute the R functions in order to achieve near native performance. And there are several approaches, actually, to do such stuff. And I want to introduce you like to three ways you could do, and then I will introduce you to the way we did it. So like yesterday, we had a presentation about the streaming API in Python. We already saw a similar approach how it is handled in Python. So when you have your normal Flink structure, so you have your job manager, task manager, and you have your tasks. So in order to execute an R user-defined function, you would start next to your task manager R processes for the task, which then executes your user-defined function. Let's look at this in more detail. So let's say we have a filter function you see here on the right, defined in R, where we want to filter the language column only for those languages we want that have R in it. So what you actually do, you would get the tuples into the Flink filter function, and then the filter function would have to serialize the tuple, send it to the R process. There you have to deserialize it, execute the R function with the tuple, serialize again, and send back to Flink. As you can imagine, this is like inter-process communication between the JVM and the R process, and you have to serialize and deserialize all the time, which in the end is really not performant. And the second reason, it's not too bad, but still you have to, like, Java and R have to compete for the memory. So the memory you gave to Flink is basically not available anymore for R for the execution of the user-defined function. So this is actually working, but not really performant. There's another way. We could do source-to-source translation. So let's say we have a restricted set of operations we want to directly translate to the native Dataflow API. This is actually the way SparkR does it. So this is for a restricted set of operations. They can support source-to-source translation to their data frame API they have in Scala. So for instance, when you see this filter function, again, the same one as shown before, you would just directly translate it to the Scala code you see on the right, which is the native Scala API of Spark. The same way goes for this user-defined function. So for a restricted set, they can execute, for instance, numerical operations like this multiplication here, and then translate it directly to their native API. So now you get native performance for user-defined functions, but you cannot support this for all arbitrary user-defined functions. So what SparkR does, for instance, as soon as you have more complex code in your user-defined function, they have to fall back to the approach I showed you before, which is sending the tuples to an external R process. Okay, now we have this hybrid approach. Can we do better? And as we saw yesterday, there's another option, basically. Why don't we execute directly on the JVM? So as we heard yesterday, there's, for instance, an implementation for Python on top of the JVM, so we can execute the code there. But why is this a problem normally? So there's this thing, the hotspot. So the hotspot is the execution engine for the for your Java code, basically. And what you do, you have a Java file, you compile it with Java C, you get your bytecode, and then this bytecode is fed into your runtime, in your JVM. And then, basically, you cross your fingers, and you want that the JIT compilation, this little thing shown on the left bottom, is kicking in and compiles your bytecode to native machine code, and the execution gets really fast. But this JIT compiler here is really a beast, so there are very few people understanding this thing. It's written in C++, it's really complicated, as you think. And so you are more or less, a lot of implementations on top of the JVM have problems that they can reliably do just-in-time compilation. So you do not really know, if I write this kind of code, bytecode, then I will be guaranteed that I get just-in-time compilation. So the guys from Oracle thought the same thing. Why don't we do something easier? So what did they do? They factored out the just-in-time compilation from the hotspot and introduced Graal, which is another compiler for bytecode to machine code, but now it's written in Java, which is much more easier to understand. And you can basically define your own compiler directives and so on, and explicitly instruct the compiler to do optimization and stuff. Still, this is just this is yeah a compiler. So not that many people really want to deal with compiler techniques, and it's still complicated. So they added another layer basically, which is Truffle. And Truffle is basically a really thin layer where you can define an abstract syntax tree. So nodes, for instance, for add, to introduce programming languages on top of this layer that then get automatically optimized by Graal. And you do not have to really deal about think about the compilation optimization techniques. So and this whole thing now, Truffle Graal and the hotspot, is called Graal VM, and it's open source. And yeah, and from starting from JDK 9, you can use it like as a plugin in the normal JVM. And to give you a bigger view, basically, in this ecosystem, we use an implementation of R, which is called Truffle R or Fast R, to execute our R code. And then this one is optimized with Truffle and executed on Graal, and we achieve near native performance on the JVM, as well as with Java. If you want to learn more about that, I have this link here on the bottom where it is explained in great detail. So, but for our specific case, we want to use FastR as an implementation for executing our R stuff. So this now allows us to execute R code and Java code in the same JVM. So we have no process intercommunication. As well, what we can do is we can infer the results types of R functions, so we do not have to specify explicit return types of R functions, which you have to do, for instance, in Spark R. And another really, really important thing is that we can access Java data types, or in our case, Flink data types written in Java, in R. And I will give you a concrete example about what that means in a few seconds. So let's have a look how we now execute R stuff in Flink with FastR. So what you see here is, again, the typical Flink infrastructure, your job manager, two task managers. On the left, you will see like code you would write in our R abstraction. So you say you want to connect to a server, and you define a specific degree of parallelism. And then you say, I want to read a data frame from a specific source. I define the column names. And this is the only point where I have to define types, is when I read. We could do that with sampling as well. This is just an implementation detail if you want to do it. And then you see, OK, I want to execute this user-defined function, which basically splits the sentences in the body column by white space, and afterwards counts the length. And this we want to assign to a new column called word count. Afterwards, we write the data frame to a sync and execute. So, and the three steps in order to execute this now in FastR are, I want to translate data frame rows to Flink tuples in the user-defined function. I want to determine the return types of the user-defined function. And afterwards, I want to create a complete execution plan. And to give you like a detail about the steps, we now have a look at the user-defined function. So on the top, you see the user-defined function we introduced in our program. And on the bottom, you see the code when we rewrote it, actually. So you see we transformed it to an R function that expects a tuple, which is in our case then a Flink tuple, because we can, as you see in step one, rewrite the DF. The access to the body column in our data frame completely to an access to a tuple with the index 2. So as you saw before, we have the ID, then the body. So and the indexing starts with 1 in R, so don't be confused. So the second index of our tuple is the body. So we split it. It's like the function shown in the top. And then what you can do, we can extend our tuples. So before we had a tuple of type 2, of length 2. Now we have a tuple of length 3. And we can actually create a Flink tuple. This is really an instance of the Java Flink tuple inside our R function without any overhead crossing the language barrier between R and Java. This is very important because otherwise we would have, imagine we would have to return a list and then basically iterate over the list in our external call in Java. So once we have this function, we can actually call them in the task manager. Like this is a pseudocode on the right, so we should just would just say execute R function and then provide the tuple. So now that we have that, I can show you some very preliminary results. So this is on a single node because you just want to show comparing R with Flink executing on 1 to 16 nodes. So you see this dot on the 500, this is normal R. The green dot is faster, and yeah, as you see, the blue one is Flink native, and the red one is Flink faster. On the right side, you see it without the R execution to have a better scaling. And you see we have a little bit of overhead, but we have almost native performance. The same goes with bigger data sizes, and you actually see the bigger the data size, the more we align to the normal native Flink execution. And I mean, 14 gigabytes is not that much. We could go larger, and then we would have even less overhead. The same thing now distributed, and now you have Spark in the picture as well. So you see Flink faster and Spark native are almost not visible if you have Sparker as well, because the thing is Sparker has to do this inter-process communication, and this one, it just takes too much time. And then on the left again, sorry, on the right again, you see the execution without Sparker to have a like finer granularity. And it's for 1 gigabyte. And if I show you the same picture for larger data sizes, you see the overhead of faster shrinks exactly. And Sparker stays really slow. The thing is, this is really only for user-defined function. You cannot source-to-source translate. Otherwise, Sparker would really be on par with Spark, which is also really great. Okay, to conclude, we have a data frame abstraction with faster and Flink that gives you distributed computation. Even on a single node execution, you already gain performance, and you gain more performance if you do real distributed computation. We approach the native performance, and actually this opens up interesting opportunities. So this approach can be extended to streaming as well. We just did it for batch because data frames really match the batch execution. You could apply to other dynamic languages like JavaScript, and you can really also introduce some more re-optimizations later on based on Truffle and Graal. So thank you very much for your attention, and I'm open for questions.
Thank you. Questions?
Thank you for your talk. I was wondering, you said in Spark they do the source-to-source translation,
yes,
right? So in the end they have a native Spark job.
Yes.
Okay. So, I mean, you could also do that for Flink, right? Just implement like native Flink.
Yeah, but like the, absolutely, you can do that. The only problem is when you really have so you have to do the source-to-source translation for every type and every operator in R.
Okay.
That's the problem, basically. So that's why they restrict the set to the basic functionality they also have in the SQL data frame abstraction. So you can do a multiplication, subtraction, and so on. But as soon as you do like string split or something, I showed you there, you are more or less, you have to fall back to this inter-process communication. That's the problem, actually.
Okay. Are there some things you cannot do currently?
Yes, for sure. I'm limited by the support of FastR.
Okay.
So whenever they do not support something, I cannot support it as well. Yeah.
Okay. And could you also think about like a hybrid solution wherever it's like really easy to like do a source-to-source translation, just do the source-to-source translation, and otherwise just fall back to...
So I think we could do that, but then we would not gain the performance from Truffle Graal, because what you actually do with the Truffle and Graal approach, you inline everything in one huge function, and then you do optimization and specialization for that, and you cannot get that with source-to-source translation.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
In the other benchmarks that you were showing, is all of that running actually on the Graal VM, or is...
No,
is
that's so... This one is actually all on the Graal VM, but I have also benchmarks without EGRAALVM, because they changed some stuff, you get more or less the same performance. So for Java, the performance stays more or less the same. But for instance, when you write code in Scala, it gets faster, actually. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Any more questions?
How much access does this provide to other Flink ecosystem like sources and things? Also maybe things like state access?
This is really prototypical in the moment. So we have, you can read CSV files, text files, and you have all the basic operators, but there's no state management and stuff currently inside.
So would this imply that when a new source is added, you first have to create like a wrapper in R, so add it to your R API first?
I'm not sure if I got your question.
Well, you've written an API in R.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So when we add a new, or when a new connector is added to Flink, like, I don't know, let's say a new Kafka connector, then you would have to first modify the R API first before one
yes.
could use it.
Yes, okay. We would have to introduce it as well. Yes.
Okay, good.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.